Okay, so I'm Terry. That's the label I go by. And I was asked to speak a little bit about my journey, which I'll just touch on. I won't go into too much detail. But I got involved in spirituality, or what I then called spirituality, or what others were calling spirituality, rather a long time ago, mid-80s. And I looked at all sorts of different things. And this is a short version. And in the end, I was still left wanting. I did enough seeking and enough looking to come to the conclusion that basically everything that I was looking at was, I was being asked to put faith in a belief, and I just couldn't do it. There was something innately in me that somehow believed that there was something other than what I'd looked at. And I used to have people come up to me all the time and say, Terry, you just need to have faith. And I couldn't, you know. I mean, I had faith that the sun was going to come up the next day and so on and so forth. But in terms of, you know, some sort of omnipotent presence or some God, or, you know, I mean, I kind of walked down the Christianity path for a while and was expected to just have faith, just believe, you know. And I couldn't. I couldn't. That's not true. I could have, but I wasn't convinced that, I wasn't convinced of which path to go down, because everyone was saying that theirs was the right path, you know. And I had enough common sense to kind of realize that. And so I elected to not go down any of them. I walked down a few of them, a bit of a way. And again, I was left wanting, you know. And I remember, you know, someone said to me once, you know, why do you have so much difficulty just believing? Why do you have so much difficulty in having a faith in a God or some, you know, separate being? And I said, I don't know. All I know is if I can't shake hands with God, it's crap. I was a kid, I was 25, but that's what was coming up for me at the time. If I can't meet God, if I can't know God, I'm not interested. You know? And I got to a point where I was not only was I dissatisfied, but I was scared, because I had enough understanding to realize that a life, or my life, run on self, run on me, was probably going to be pretty bloody disastrous. At my best efforts, it was going to be pretty disastrous. And that scared me, you know. And I got to a point where I just decided to let go of seeking, let go of the searching, just let go. But I was scared. And I had a friend of mine say that there was this guy giving a talk tonight at such and such a place, and why don't you just come along to that and have a listen to that? And I was like, fuck, another one? Like, really? Another one? You know? And I made a deal with this person that if I went, that they would never ever talk to me about God or spirituality ever again, if I went. they agreed. So I went, and there was only about 18 people, about as many people that are here today, 18 people sitting in the room, and it was a long table, thin table, you know, enough to take just one chair at one end and one chair at the other end, and there was 8 people sitting either side of this table, and I was out the front having a cigarette, just going, oh, I don't want to go in, I don't want to go in, I don't want to go in, you know, this is all bullshit, I don't want to go in. Anyway, I finished my cigarette and walked inside, and the only seat available was one chair at the far end of this long table, and I sat down there, and the guest speaker had already started speaking, and I walked in and sat down, and I looked up at this person, and I just went, oh no. And I just made an immediate judgment, and I just put my head down, and this person was wearing a beret and had a beard, and was old. I thought, I was 25. Old person was actually only the same age I am now, but anyway. And I made a judgment. I just went, oh, okay, this is it. It's all over, you know. I'm just going to have to try and do my best to get on with my life and live it like, you know, most people seem to live it, and just kind of do my best. But I had my head down on the table, and my head wouldn't stop. I was like, what do I do? What now? Like, okay, I'm just going to have to try and live my life. There's just this noise going on in my head. And that carried on for about 5 minutes. So I didn't hear anything that the guest speaker, not a word, was saying for that first 5 minutes. And eventually, about 5 minutes in, all my thinking stopped. I didn't do any of that, by the way. It just stopped, and all of a sudden I could hear another voice in the room other than the voice that was going on in my head, you know. And I looked up, and there was this person sitting at the other end of the table, and they paused and looked at me, and a big smile came up on this person's face, and just happened to be Bob, happened to be Sailor Bob, sitting right there in the audience, you know. And the person that I'd criticised 5 minutes earlier, you know, great judge of character. Not. I was so far off the mark. And he spoke for about 20, 25 minutes, something like that. And at that time, I couldn't actually understand. I was trying to piece together what it was that he was saying, but something in me just kept saying, this is it. This is what I've been looking for. This is what this guy's saying was making perfect sense on one level, and on another level, I didn't understand it. It was quite bizarre how it happened, but something resonated in me, and I just focused in. I just listened to every single word he said, and he just kept looking at me. He didn't look at anyone else in the room. He just kept looking at me for the next 25 minutes and talked to me. It was incredible. And got to the end of the meeting. We didn't know each other. Never met again. Got to the end of the meeting, and I thought, I'm never going to be able to get near this guy. Everyone's just going to swamp him, you know. And I just wanted to grab a hold of him and talk to him. Again, great judge of character. Got to the end of the meeting, and no one went near him. I was stunned. I was totally stunned. Bob was standing on one side of the room, and I was standing on the other side of the room, and no one went near him. Anyway, so we walked towards each other and welcome, and introduced each other, and that was the beginning of a relationship that I've had with Bob for the last 34 years. My God, you know, I was my son's age when I met Bob, and Bob was my age now, you know. And I used to think he was old. Anyway.
He's young now.
He's young now. Yeah, yeah. I certainly am. So I spent a lot of time. I spent a lot of time with Bob. Bob was gracious enough to open his home, and when he was living up in Kalorama, Sassafras, Kalorama. And I went up there virtually every day for about 6 months, and just opened his home and his garden. We would walk around the garden, or we'd be sitting inside talking, and he just devoted all of his time to me, you know, which is incredible. I'd never experienced that with another human being before, you know. He was just there. And I spent about 6 months with Bob, you know, and then he started up a group and started going on to that. Anyway, and there's more to my story. There's a lot more to my story. I've been involved in drugs and all sorts of shit when I was younger, and, you know, and that's another story in and of itself. But I guess what I was trying to, what I discovered was I was always a seeker. I was always trying to find something that was either going to make me feel better, or make me into a better person, or a bigger, brighter, more vibrant person, or whatever, you know. And like so many of us, I went down the drug path thinking that, you know, I was going to find it there. You know, I didn't find it in society. I didn't find it in my parents when I was growing up, and that came along, and I was a young kid, you know, and I experimented around with that, only to find it wasn't there. That really gave me a good hard slapping. And in the end, I got thrown back on myself. And Bob kept constantly throwing me back on myself, you know. He wasn't giving me a belief system at all. Constantly, he just kept saying to me, inquire for yourself. But here's some beautiful pointers along the way for me to actually do that, you know. So he wasn't preaching a doctrine. He wasn't preaching a belief system. In fact, a lot of the times he would say, look, what I'm saying isn't it, you know. It's kind of confused me at the start, you know, like, what do you mean by that? But after a while, I started to understand, you know, what he was saying. And indeed, anything I say about non-duality today is not it. No matter what I say, it's not actually it. All I can do is try and point and get you guys to look for yourself and see for yourself, you know. I could sit here for the next 2 hours and just describe what an apple tastes like if you've never tasted an apple. I could sit here for 2 hours just describing it, you know. And until you bit into that apple yourself, all you've got is a conceptual understanding of what I've said in regards to an apple. So the same is in regards to turning in and looking for yourself and discovering who and what you actually really are. Okay, so all I can do is point. I'll try and point to the best of my ability. So non-duality, that implies non-dual, it implies not two. It implies one. All the great religions confirm that. There is only one God. The only problem with that is what I said before. They all think their God's the one. Okay. However, you know, primarily what they're saying is there is just one God, you know, or oneness, if you like. I'm going to try not to use the word God if I can help it, but sometimes it slips out of my mouth. So what does that mean? Non-duality, like, what do you mean one? You know, how can there just be one, given I'm here and you're there and the couch is there and there's a moon in the sky? It implies many, you know. What is this one, you know? And this is about self-inquiry. So Bob used to say to me often that the me, well, actually he didn't say that. What he used to say to me was, you know, T Terry's got to go. And of course, as a, you know, as a me, there's part of me that took offense to that, you know, like I thought he was being critical of me, like I've got to go sort of thing, you know. So I didn't really initially understand what he was talking about, but I came to see what he was talking about. So the only thing that separates me or seems to separate me from that oneness is Terry. And Bob spent a lot of time with me exploring who and what Terry is. What is that? You know, who or what is that? And that, you know, there's, gee, I absolutely believed I was. I absolutely believed I am Terry. I have a history, you know. I have free will, I can choose, I can think, I can make decisions and so on and so forth. You know, like my meanness as such felt extraordinarily real. You know? It didn't take him long actually to shatter the complete delusion of that. You know? There's a few pointers that I'll use today. One that just immediately came to mind is my whole belief system, who I believe myself to be, was all based on whatever thoughts were running through my head at any given point in time. You know? And if I, you know, if I was asked, "Who are you, Terry?" the first thing I would do is I would say, "Well, my name's Terry," you know, to the question, "Who are you, Terry?" "Well, my name's Terry, and I was born such and such a year, and I had such and such a parents, and I went to such and such a school, and teachers, and I had friends in school," and I would paint this big diatribe, this big long story, not about who I am, but what had happened, you know. And the question, "Who am I?" actually relates to right here, right now, in this present moment, like right here, right now. The closest I came when Bob used to ask me, "Who are you? What are you? Where are you? Who are you?" The closest I ever got to being able to answer that question from a me was to say, after a lot of inquiry, after a lot of self-investigation and a lot of looking for myself, the closest I could ever get to it was just for me to say, "I am memory." It's the closest I got. You can get any closer than that, you know. And a really good way of testing that, and you kind of have to use your imagination with this particular pointer, and that is, you know, if I could create, I can't, but so imagination is required. If I could create amnesia in every single solitary person sitting in this room right now, and your history was completely wiped, gone, no memory, no history, don't even know your name. You can still speak. You haven't lost the ability to speak English or to understand what others are saying, but your complete history is just wiped, completely gone. Who would you be then? Who would you be then? Without the memory, who would you be? There should be a blankness that comes up there, you know, if you're really looking. There'll be a pause and a blankness that should come up. Now, without that memory, do you disappear? If I was able to create amnesia, would you disappear? You'd still be sitting here, wouldn't you? Yeah? So that would still be sitting here, who or what's that? because that's here in the present moment. That's real. That's here. Can't be denied. There's a presence, there's an aliveness, and there's an awareness that would be here right now. So, if you're like me, what I kept trying to do prior to meeting Bob, and even some of the way into some of the teachings or pointers that Bob was using with me, what I was trying to do was I was still trying to become something, and I was still trying to attain something, get something. You know, this wasn't good enough. Life wasn't, you know, my me-ness as such wasn't good enough. I need to become a better me, you know. And then I started to learn what enlightenment was, and I went, oh shit, I want that. Give me that. What do I need to do to get that? You know, and then I was wide open, like I became a sponge with Bob, you know. And he kept saying to me, there's no such thing as enlightenment. What do you fucking mean there's no such thing as enlightenment? You know, what do you mean? So what I started to see, what I started to realize over the course of Bob's teachings was that Bob used to say to me, yeah, there's nothing to get, there's nothing to attain, there's nothing to become, and enlightenment is a falsehood. There's nobody, no one to become enlightened. What does that mean? You know, and I struggled with that for a little while. So this idea of you're already, what you're seeking, you already are. What you're looking for, you already are. Whatever method is being used. We're always trying to become something. Yeah? But what we are seeking, we actually already are it. So, if that's the case, why doesn't it feel like that? Why don't I experience that here now? Oh, maybe there's something else I need to learn. Nope. It's the complete reverse, actually. Complete reverse. And I sometimes say, you know, there's nothing to gain, there's plenty to lose. What do I mean by that? Nothing to get, nothing to become, nothing to have, because you already are that. But there's plenty to lose, seemingly. What could I mean by that? What stands in the way of that presenceness, of that awakeful state? State, wrong word. What stands in the way? Me stands in the way. Me, the one that wants to get it, stands in the way. You know? And it's nothing but a complete belief system. It's not a fact. This meanness is not actually a fact. What I love about non-duality is not spiritual. It's so not spiritual. It just deals with fact and truth, and for you to look for yourself. Don't believe anything I say, like I said at the beginning. Anything I say ain't it. It's not. So don't hang on to a concept, or don't hang on to an idea, anything that I say. Don't grab it. I used the pointer earlier about amnesia. Memory's gone. What would stand in the way then? Where would you be other than here? Present. Okay, so Let's look at the me. What is the me? Yep. How does the me function? What does it rely on to function? It relies on thoughts to function. It relies on thoughts to be. For the me to be, relies on thoughts. Okay. Thoughts work in the pairs of polaric opposites. That's the only way thoughts function. Hot, cold, somewhere in between. Here, there, somewhere in between. Me, you, somewhere in between. This, that. Up, down, left, right. That's the only way thinking can function. It's the only way it works. So it's for it to function, it splits. It's split. And in that splitness, it creates the idea of a me and a you, or a this and a that, or a me and a God, or me and enlightenment, or me and whatever. The me is nothing but thoughts. And if they all disappeared, if all thoughts, your own thoughts I'm talking about, if they all completely disappeared, where would your me be? Could you say it still is here? Wouldn't be able to say anything, because there'd be no thought. You'd just be. All the great teachers, all the sages, Bob, all of them, they all talk about arriving at a beingness, arriving here. They all say that. Why the hell are they saying that? Are they bullshitting? How hard is it to be? How difficult is it to be here? Here. Try not being here. That's much harder. Try not being here. Can you ever not be here? For yourself, I'm referring to. Yep. Can you ever not be here? You're always here. So we've got a mind that works in the pairs of polaric opposites. It's either in the past or it's in the future. That's where it resides. Doesn't reside in the present moment. Doesn't. Absolutely doesn't. In the present moment, thinking stops. It can't operate, it can't function in the present moment because there's no split in the present moment. So we say, oh, I wasn't present, I was in my head, I was in the past. You're always present. You're always present. Just that we identify with what goes on in our head and call that me. Here's the irony about that. We don't even choose what happens in our head. It just happens. I don't know about you, but if I had any choice over what went on in my head, 99% of what used to go on in my head, I would switch off. Okay, I'm going to take a break for a couple of days. I'm just going to choose to think nothing. After all, I'm the creator of my thoughts. So I'm just going to switch it off. And just be. And chill and relax and watch the sun come up and the breeze blow by and feel the wind blowing over my body and smell the scent of flowers in the air and just going to take a break. Or I might choose to have nothing but blissful thoughts. That's it. I'm in control. I'm the chooser. I'm the thinker. So from this point forward, for the rest of my life, till the day this body drops and dies, I'm just going to think nothing but blissful thoughts. Can't do it. Just can't do it. So all this dialogue that goes on in our head, which by the way creates our me, all this dialogue that goes on in our head, you're completely 100% powerless over it. It just happens. Yet we get affected by it, you know. Some people have inner critics that go on in their heads. You're worthless, you'll never amount to anything, what's the use of trying, what's wrong with you, why can't you be around people socially, whatever it is, there'll be this inner critic that goes on, which again is just a random bunch of thoughts that just float through our head, and they don't stay there, they float through. Not one single thought ever permanently stays there, it just comes up from God only knows where do thoughts come from? Where do they arise from? We don't even consider even thinking about that or looking at that. They come up, they'll float through for a moment, then they disappear. Disappear into where?
To someone else.
You can be sitting in your room by yourself. A whole lot of random stuff will come up and then it'll disappear. Where does it come from and where does it go to? Just stuff we don't even consider looking at. So we bring the past into the present, which is the utmost in insanity. We bring the past into the present and call that me, the past. Can anybody really bring any part of the past into the present? Can you bring yesterday into today? I'm talking about the day, not the thoughts of the day, the actual day. Can you bring that into today? Can't. All we've got is ideas, concepts. Our past, our histories, nothing but concepts. And then those same concepts then project into the future. God, what happens if this happens? Or I'm going to go and do this. I'm going to create that. Or the future's going to... Can't wait for this particular time in the future when I'm going to get this or I'm going to become. It's laughable. Like, really? Really, it's laughable. You've got to be able to see this. You've got to be able to see this. So, why is it, I'm going to use one of Bob's pointers here, and I love this one. Why is it we can't remember back any younger than about the age of 2? Why can't we do that? Whatever your earliest memory is, doesn't matter how old you get, you can still remember that. Doesn't matter how old you get, you can still remember your earliest memory. Why can't we remember any earlier than 2? Why can't I remember being born? Why can't I remember suckling on mum's tit? What's missing in that first 2-year period? Yeah. Thank you. Words. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was God, and the Word was with God, I think it goes. In the Bible. Hello. In the beginning was the Word. In your beginning was the Word. Your idea of me, of self, is based on Word, which is taught. It's a language. And Word is only a sound. And we're taught that a particular sound means something. Then the problem is, we then take the Word to be the actual thing. It's only ever a description. So the description is never the actual. It's only ever a description. Even if you tell me about your history, you give me a description, not the event. None of the events. Any traumas that we may be suffering presently from something that happened 10, 20, 30, 40 years ago, what we're reliving over and over and over and over in the present moment in relation to that trauma is a description of it, not the actual event. a description. So all our me is a description. Is that all we are? Is that all you are? A description? Like, it's common sense. It's really common sense, if you look at it. I just had nobody point this stuff out to me before. Thank you, Bob. I had no one point it out to me. As soon as he started pointing it out to me, it was like, oh my God, what have I been? What have I been doing? You know, it just... It's laughable. It really is laughable. And you know when someone starts to say it, because they start to laugh. You can't not laugh. Like, really. It's absurd, the absurdity of it. Yeah? So, generally, what people will do if this resonates for them. And there's some people it doesn't, and that's fine. Do you know what I mean? But some people it does. And generally, what people are encouraged to do initially, some people say, what's the practice? What do I need to practice to get closer to this or to, you know, see this? Well, it's not really a practice as such, okay? But like if I said, I don't know, look at that little picture up there on the wall, and everybody glanced and looked up at it, is that a practice? Would you consider that a practice? It's not a practice, is it? It's not. Can you just look at, there it is, okay? So what we are encouraged to do is go looking for ourself, this supposed me. Go looking for it. Watch it. Look for it. There's no practicing in looking. Just looking. What is it? Where is it? Can you find any center in this body where the me resides? If you look for yourself, where is it located? Generally, what we're aware of most as people is what rattles on between our ears. That's what we notice most. That's where most of our attention is. On me. Ew, that's not very spiritual. But it's the truth. And it needs to be seen. It needs to be seen. Thoughts come and go. They just come and go. And your whole identity, that whole notion of a me, is a thought only. Just a thought. We assume me is here. We assume it. We don't even look, but we assume that there's a me here. Everything that we do from the standpoint of an isolated, separate me, everything that we do or look at or become aware of or whatever the case may be, is objective. We always look out. Even looking for an answer or looking for a spiritual path or a teacher or a guide or a preacher or the right church or the right psychologist or the right therapist or whatever, we're always looking out. We never look in. We never look in. We don't even question whether the me is real or not. Just assume, you know, I feel like I'm here. Yep, there's a me here. And even when you're looking, even when you're observing, thoughts come and go. They're objective as well. to be aware of something, even if it's thoughts, you've got to be separate from it. Do you understand that? You've got to be separate from it. Whatever you're being aware of, you've got to be separate from it to be aware of it. And if everyone in the room can be aware of thoughts, how the fuck can you be them? Your whole identity is based on that. All of it. All of it. It's whatever thoughts say. Just pause, and do a 180. Just turn around and look, as opposed to looking out all the time. Just pause, turn, and look. Tell me what you find. Consider this for a moment. If you're aware of thoughts, that awareness in your own direct experience now, that awareness that is aware of thought, is it split? Is it split? Just look. Is there any division in it? Does it judge? Does it criticize? The common mistake we make is, first there's I, which is me. Then there's presence, and then there's awareness. First there's I. So first there's me, then there's presence that I experience, and then there's awareness, or if you want to call that presence, aliveness. Yeah, an aliveness. It's the other way around. It's actually the other way around if you look for yourself. I can't remember who, you'd remember, Kat, who coined the phrase, I think, therefore I am. Who's that? Eckhart. Yep. Yeah. It's the opposite. That's wrong. That's actually so wrong. I don't know how many people have been fucked up because of their belief in that. It's not I think, therefore I am. It's I am, therefore I think.
Wasn't it Shakespeare that said I think, therefore I am? Wasn't it Shakespeare?
To
be or not to be was Shakespeare.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Okay.
And even that, to be or not to be, that is the question. To be or not to be, that's the answer. That's the answer. We get it all around the wrong way. Yeah. So that beingness or that aliveness or that here-ness or that awareness is first. That's what you experienced when you were a baby before words got overlaid on the top of it, and an identity then gets created on top of that presence awareness. How can we say me comes first? It's ridiculous. And because of that idea, me comes first, it then goes looking for itself. It goes looking for itself. That it's looking for, it is. It's crazy, crazy, crazy. And it's so clear if you actually pause and stop and look for yourself. Just look for yourself. These pointers that I've given today, that should be enough. Really, if you genuinely have a look, it should be enough. In the beginning was the Word. Around 2 years of age. That's when your self-identity, that's when your meanness gets created. And you don't even have any choice over that. I didn't choose my name. Do you know what I mean? I didn't choose how my parents treated me at two. I didn't choose what they indoctrinated into me at two or three or four or five or six or seven or eight or nine or ten. I didn't choose any of that. There's a system, and I go to school, and all that other stuff gets pumped into you as well. Education, and like, you know, and then we become that. And we're not that.
It's the original conspiracy, I guess.
Yeah. It is a bit. It is. So there's a presence. There's a presence and there's an awareness. And no one sitting in the room right now can say, I am not. You'd have to be there to say it. Can't say, I am not. So even this dialogue that seems to be happening right now isn't coming from a me to another me. I'm not talking to a me at all. I love Bob's saying, you know, I'm speaking to that I am that I am. Awareness, if you like, speaking to awareness, not the me. The me is a fiction. It's not real. It's not actually a thing as such. Yeah? You seeing this? Yeah. You can see, it can't help but put a smile on your face. It can't. It can't help but put a smile on your face. It's just, it's ridiculous. So that we're looking for, you know,
we are.
And it's only a me that feels it's not complete. It's only a me, thoughts, ideas, that feels it's not complete. It's that goes looking for this. And it can never have it. It can never have it. It can't even understand it. It's like us, like the me trying to understand that there's no beginning and no end to the universe. Like what? It's gotta be, you know, some beginning and end point somewhere. Again, that's dualistic thinking, and that's the only way it can operate. It can't know wholeness. It can't know oneness. It can't. It just can't. Here's what it does. And we do this when we're kids, yeah? Who created everything, Dad? God did, son. Who created God? It's the very next question. You know? And if you try and intellectualize or come to an understanding of what this presence is, those sorts of questions will come up too. In whatever shape or form. So, trying to get this or understand this or grasp it from the mind, you'll do that forever. It's not possible. It's the mind that's in the way. It's the mind that's in the way. It's what I meant earlier by there's nothing to gain, well, there's plenty to lose, seemingly. It's twice I've said seemingly. Because there's nothing to actually lose. It's fiction, fantasy. It's nothing. It's not even... There's nothing substantial to it at all. Thoughts I'm talking about. A thought can't see. A thought can't hear. You don't need a thought to see and hear. The seeing and the hearing just happens. Problem is, our me steps in and claims ownership of it and says, I see. Bullshit. Crap. Get out of the way. Seeing still happens. And I could go to the body too, and we could talk about that, you know. Yeah, I am the body, and so on and so forth. I don't think I'll touch on that today, but it's the same thing applies. If it's objective, if you can be aware of it, it can't be you. Are you aware of the body? Yep. Okay, that's good enough. We've just covered the body. We have. Can't be you. If you can be aware of it, can't be you. I don't know how long I've spoken for, Rich.
No, but that was a bloody good point. If you can be aware of your thoughts, you can't be your thoughts.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
<It's>,
yeah.
You know, and you can... That's your own understanding then. That's your truth then. You see that, and it becomes your truth. Not an idea. You see it as a truth, as a fact. I'll finish there. If anyone's got any questions, I'm happy to. I'll have a shot at trying to answer them. Some I may not be able to, but I'll have a shot at trying to answer them if anyone's got any questions.